Hey, Michelle, I got a Glock in my roar.
This is so stupid. Barack Obama would beat John McCain in the 2008 election. Voter turnout in this election was high, and 8 states broke away from the Republican Party in order to cast a vote for Barack Obama, which isn't surprising considering how bad the economy was in 2008. This would be the first election in 56 years that did not feature an incumbent president or vice president. It was also the first election that featured 2 senators. Obama would also be the first African-American president in the history of the United States. When it comes to the cabinet, the Secretary of State was Hillary Clinton, who was replaced by John Kerry in 2013. Huh, I guess Obama just really likes his election losers in that position. The Secretary of the Treasury was Tim Geithner, who was replaced by Jack Lew in 2013. The Secretary of Defense was Robert Gates, who also served under Bush, who was replaced by Leon Panetta in 2011, who was replaced by Chuck Hagel in 2013, who was replaced by Ashton Carter in 2015. The Attorney General was Eric Holder, who was replaced by Loretta Lynch in 2015. The Secretary of the Interior was Ken Salazar, who was replaced by Sally Jewell in 2013. The Secretary of Agriculture was Tom Vilsack. The Secretary of Commerce was Gary Locke, who was replaced by John Bryson in 2011, who resigned in 2012, leaving the post vacant until 2013, when Penny Pritzker took over. The Secretary of Labor was Hilda Solis, who was replaced by Tom Perez in 2013. The Secretary of Health was Kathleen Sebelius, who was replaced by Sylvia Burwell in 2014. The Secretary of Housing was Sean Donovan, who was replaced by Julian Castro in 2014. The Secretary of Transportation was Ray LaHood, who was replaced by Anthony Fox in 2013. The Secretary of Energy was Stephen Chu, who was replaced by Ernest Moniz in 2013. The Secretary of Education was Arne Duncan, who was replaced by John King Jr. in 2016. The Secretary of Veterans was Eric Kaczynski, who was replaced by Robert McDonald in 2014. And the Secretary of Homeland Security was Janet Napolitano, who was replaced by Jed Johnson in 2013. Barack Obama took a similar approach to the cabinet as Bush did, typically replacing each secretary after each term. Obama had a similar turnover rate that Bush did too, with a very uncorrupt cabinet. He is also very similar to past presidents in replacing the Secretary of Defense after every 2 years. These seem to be trends, but we have to see if that sticks if Biden ends up winning the next election. What is also interesting about Obama's cabinet is that he included 2 Republicans in the cabinet and Robert Gates and Ray LaHood. Obama would also replace 2 justices in his tenure. Sonia Sotomayor would replace David Soter and Elena Kagan to replace John Paul Stevens. Both of these judges were liberals, so it didn't really change the complexion of the courts. Obama would get a chance to change the complexion of the courts in 2016 when he could have replaced Justice Anton Scalia after he died in 2016, but that will be a story for later. First, let's start on foreign policy. Obama would begin his presidency by banning torture techniques that were used under the Bush administration and by ordering the closing of Guantanamo Bay within a year. The deadline would not be met, and there were still a lot of torture techniques that were used by American agencies during Obama's tenure. Obama would also propose a fresh start with Russia and would issue a hand to the Muslim world after visiting Cairo, which didn't help the extremely false allegations peddled by conservative outlets that Obama was a Muslim. Obama would also expand much of the force that was used by the Bush administration through the expansion of war and national security policies. He also only issued a mild condemnation of the Iranian government following their crackdown on protesters in 2009. National security would further be questioned after an attempted terrorist attack on Detroit in 2009 by a Nigerian group. Obama would also increase the amount of troops in Afghanistan to 60,000 men and start to ramp up the operation while also starting to remove troops from the occupation of Iraq. The majority of the forces would be withdrawn from Iraq by 2010, leaving about 50,000 men at the start of his presidency. In Afghanistan, Obama would send a surge of 33,000 troops and start ordering the training of the Afghan army so that they could fight the Taliban on their own. He would also take the number all the way down to 150 men by 2011. Obama would also become embroiled in the building of a mosque near the 9/11 attacks. While he believed that the mosque should be built, he wanted it to be moved somewhere else. The Obama administration would support the protests that were occurring in the Middle East during the Arab Spring. In most cases, Obama would not intervene in the countries directly, instead supporting them from a distance. But in Libya, Obama would support a bombing campaign to overthrow Gaddafi and help bring an end to his regime in 2011. Obama would be successful, but would not occupy Libya. And he did all this by using the War Powers Resolution and without the authorization of Congress. The decision not to occupy Libya would lead to Libya collapsing after the toppling of Gaddafi and fracturing into many different groups, becoming the mess that it is today. Around this time, Obama would also announce to the world that the United States had successfully killed Osama bin Laden in a SEAL Team 6 raid, who was hiding in a residential complex in Abbottabad, Pakistan. May he rest in peace. During his re-election campaign, Obama would also have to deal with the Benghazi attacks, which was a planned terrorist attack on the Benghazi compound in Libya. Obama and his Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, would take responsibility for the attack. A cover-up of the events that transpired would be found in 2013, which was a cover-up that was done to protect Obama during the election. The Benghazi attacks showed that while the airstrikes in Libya were successful, it meant that the aftermath was uncontrollable by the American government and led to an attack on a U.S. embassy. Another Obama-era scandal was the Fast and Furious scandal. Operation Fast and Furious was an attempt by the ATF to prevent gun smuggling by conducting research on it. This led to the ATF allowing 2,000 guns to flow through Mexico by the smugglers, one of these which would be found in El Chapo's home. The operation would lead to the death of many Mexicans, as well as a Border Patrol agent in the U.S. The ATF kept a database on suspected straw buyers that would cross into Mexico in order to see where the guns would end up. The blame was placed on 14 individuals, and the aftermath of the operation led to a cover-up by the Justice Department. Obama would also be criticized as the economy slowly got better and unemployment continued to climb. Obama would attempt to enact bipartisan healthcare reforms, but would find that the Republicans and Democrats were too busy squabbling with each other to actually get anything done. Some things just never change. The reforms would become harder to pass as the Libertarian Conservative Tea Party movement would rise. I will cover that movement in another video, but the basics that you need to know for now is that they opposed any government intervention that would lead to what they saw as excessive taxes and any government intervention in the private sector entirely. Obama would be able to send more money to the automotive industry in order to keep it afloat. Obama would also pass a stimulus bill in the form of the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. This included $800 billion, with one-third going to grants to states to keep them from laying off employees, one-third in the form of tax cuts to the middle class, and one-third in the form of infrastructure projects. By the end of his presidency, unemployment would fall, inflation and interest rates remained low, but the annual growth rate remained the same as the gap between the rich and the poor continued to grow. Obama would also pass the Dodd-Frank Wall Street Reform and Consumer Protection Act in 2010. The act would require businesses to be stocked on capital, reduce the bank's ability to give out risky loans, and create the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau to monitor these banks and the loans that they give out. The Congressional Democrats would also try to pass a healthcare reform in 2009 in November that would include the creation of a public option, which is a lower-cost government-run program that would act as competition for private insurance companies. The bill would be debated by a group of six, which had three members from each party, and they would survive the Republican filibusters. Obama would push the bill and would appeal to Republicans and Democrats alike. He would even sign an executive order to make sure that the bill wouldn't push limitations on abortion funding, which some Dems were worried that it might. The bill would be passed in the House of Representatives in 2010, and a second bill that fixed the problems in the Senate bill would also pass. The legislation would become known as the Affordable Care Act and would be seen by both critics and fans as Obamacare. The final result of the bill would prohibit the denial of coverage on the basis of pre-existing conditions, extend the health care to some 30 million previously uninsured Americans, make attainment of health care insurance mandatory for all citizens, called for a tax increase on the wealthiest Americans that would largely bankroll the subsidies for premium payments for the families earning less than $88,000 a year, and would promise a tax credit to small businesses that provided health care coverage for their employees. When the Republicans took back Congress, they would consistently vote to repeal it. One of these votes even reached Obama in 2016, which Obama would of course use a veto on. Obama only vetoed 12 bills, and this was probably the most noteworthy veto. Certain aspects of the act would be challenged in the Supreme Court in cases like the National Federation of Independent Business versus Sebelius, which ruled that the law's requirement that all citizens have health care was constitutional, but the requirement to force states to expand their health care coverage was not. There was also Burwell versus Hobby Lobby, which allowed businesses to not pay for certain aspects of health care like contraceptives on religious grounds. And finally, there was King v. Burwell, which ruled that the federal government's powers to provide subsidies to poor and middle-class Americans to buy health insurance unconstitutional. Obama would have to deal with the Deepwater Horizon oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. The Department of the Interior would halt all existing offshore drilling until this spill could be dealt with. The cleanup would take a long time, but it would be dealt with for the most part. Galveston still doesn't look too great though, but then again, I'm not really a huge beach person. The Republicans would end up taking back the House in the 2010 midterms, capturing 60 seats. As a result, Obama's second half of the first term would be a bipartisan one. Obama would extend tax cuts for all Americans for another 2 years, extend the unemployment benefits, rescind the military's Don't Ask, Don't Tell rule, increase funding and scope for the school lunch program, extend medical benefits and compensation to the first responders of 9/11, got their strategic arms reduction talks treaty with Russia ratified, and would pass the Development Relief and Education for Alien Minors Act, DREAM Act, despite it being stalled by a filibuster. Obama would also respond well after Gabby Gifford was shot while talking with constituents in 2011, as he would call for the nation to unite and end the political polarization that had been plaguing the nation for the past decade. Obama's second half of the first term would also be marked with budget battles between the Democrats and Republicans. These disagreements about the budget would translate into a gridlock in Congress. This would result in an almost government shutdown in 2011. The shutdown would be avoided as the two sides agreed on a $38 billion budget cut to help balance the deficit. Another shutdown would be threatened in June as Republicans wanted more cuts as the debt ceiling approached. Obama would agree to some cuts, but also wanted a higher tax on the wealthy people to help provide for Americans and a repeal on tax breaks for corporations as well. Obama and Republican Speaker of the House John Boehner would meet to discuss the tax increases and budget cuts, but these meetings did not bear fruit. The meetings were held to find a $1.2 trillion deficit, or else the defense budget and the domestic budget would both lose $600 billion. Neither side could figure it out, so the cuts were made. Congress would still agree to raise the debt ceiling in 2012 in order to prevent more government shutdowns. Obama would also have the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act, which would provide equal pay for women and the Race to the Top initiatives in order to provide competition for the states for $4.5 billion for their educational programs, and he would also push states to improve public schools, open more charter schools, and tie teacher evaluations to student learnings. During his re-election campaign, Obama would affirm his support of same-sex marriage. The economy had also mostly recovered during this time period, but wages had remained stagnant, and the housing market still struggled. Obama would also end the immediate deportation of illegal immigrants who came to the United States as children. Obama would also promise to bring aid to the areas affected by Hurricane Sandy in 2012. Barack Obama would beat Mitt Romney of the Republicans and Gary Johnson of the Libertarians in a close election, not with Gary Johnson, and secure four more years in the presidency. He would lose electoral and popular votes in this election, becoming the first president since FDR to do so. He would also be the first president since Ronald Reagan to win both of his terms with an actual majority in the popular vote, which was over 50% and not, you know, something under 50%. After the election, Obama would again meet with Boehner in order to discuss saving the nation from the fiscal cliff, which was either the cutting of or expansion of previous policies that were expiring. These include the expiration of Bush-era tax cuts, temporary payroll tax cuts initiated by the Obama administration, some tax breaks for businesses, along with the automatic application of the across-the-board spending cuts to the military and non-military programs required by the Budget Control Act of 2011. The compromise would fail at first, but Vice President Joe Biden would work out a separate compromise with Senate Leader Mitch McConnell, and the budget would pass in 2013. In his second term, Obama's domestic agenda would take a turn towards gun legislation after the Sandy Hook Elementary shooting of 2012. He would call for legislation that would institute universal background checks for gun purchases, ban the sale of assault weapons in high capacity, which is more than 10 round magazines, provide for greater protection in the schools, and place a renewed focus on treating mental illness. Despite Republican support for the measures and Democrat breaks, these proposals would fail as the two parties agreed to a supermajority passing in order to avoid the filibuster. Obama would end up signing an executive order to expand background checks for guns and would redefine the legal regulators for guns as well in 2016. The latter part was to close the gun show loophole. Obama would attempt to replace Justice Scalia on the judiciary with Merrick Garland after Scalia's death, but was unable to do so as the Republicans vowed to not hear any nomination until the 2016 election. Obama had already replaced two justices. Historically, the Senate has denied the president the confirmation in an election year, but this would be the first time that the Senate denied a nomination of a Supreme Court judge in the election year. Obama would also nominate a majority of the judges in the appeals court, having a Democratic majority in them for the first time in a long time, filling out 54 of the 180 judges in his presidency alone. This would lead to a Democratic majority in 9 out of the 13 districts. Budget cuts would also begin in 2013 as a compromise to the cuts failed to be reached. This would cause many government agencies, most notably pertaining to air traffic, to experience many problems as they didn't have enough money to deal with the cuts. Obama would also have to face a scandal in 2013 as the IRS was found to have delayed tax-exempt status from conservative groups. Obama would condemn these actions by the IRS. Obama would also face a scandal after the Justice Department subpoenaed 20 phone lines of journalists from the Associated Press without their knowledge. Yet another scandal would come to light as it was discovered that the NSA had pushed telephone companies to hand over metadata of their customers. This was leaked by Edward Snowden. Speaking of leaks, Obama would also expand the Espionage Act to whistleblowers. This would lead to prosecutions under this act, expanding past what was done by all previous administrations combined. Previously, it had only been brought up against spies, like the Rosenbergs in 1951. Expanding the law to whistleblowers expands the government's powers by a very large amount. The Trump administration has also continued this policy. In 2013, the Republicans would issue a cut in Obamacare's funding. Obama would issue a veto, and the government would shut down for weeks. The Bipartisan Budget Act would be passed that included more balanced cuts. Following this, Obamacare's initial rollout would find trouble, as the website it was located on had a miserable performance. Even though the problems would be fixed, the reputation of Obamacare would never recover. Another thing Obama would have to deal with in this term was racial tensions in the United States, and they increased after the shooting of Michael Brown. Obama would not take a side on this issue. Obama would also not respond to the death of Eric Garner at the hands of the New York City police officer. Riots would also start up in Baltimore after a young black man was killed while in police custody in 2015. Around the same time, a shooting at the Charleston church would kill around 9 African Americans. Obama would deliver a speech talking about race relations, gun control, and the Confederate flag as a symbol. Obama would also see some Supreme Court cases, like Obergefell v. Hobbs, which would legalize same-sex marriage, and King v. Burwell, as mentioned earlier, that would help protect Obamacare. During the midterms, Obama would look to take executive action and raise the minimum wage for federal workers up to $10 an hour. He also took executive action on numerous other topics like climate change, gun control, student loans, social justice, and other things. He would also change the rules for how power plants could deal with their carbon emissions by 2030. Obama would also utilize his power for pardon for 212 people and also commuted over 1,000 sentences, which were mostly for federal drug crimes. In the 2014 midterms, the Republicans would gain 12 seats in the House and retake the Senate by adding 4 more seats to their majority. Turning back to foreign policy, Obama would send aid to Syria after death counts would rise in the Civil War. Obama would also establish a red line in Syria, which provided that no chemical weapons be used. Bashar al-Assad would cross this line repeatedly, and Obama didn't want to get in a prolonged invasion of Syria due to America's war fatigue. Obama had originally wanted to bomb Syria, and would even take it to foreign committee leaders in Congress who supported the initiative. But he also made the mistake of taking it to the American public, who would refuse to support the initiative. Facing response from the US and pressure from Russia, Bashar al-Assad would agree to get rid of his chemical weapons by 2014. Obama's foreign policy would then turn towards Ukraine and the Crimean War in 2014. Obama would condemn the invasion and place sanctions on the Russian leaders, though there was not much else he can do about the situation besides symbolic gestures about standing with Ukraine. Russia remains in control of Crimea to this day, and they are even at war with Ukraine to this day. Obama would also trade 5 members of the Taliban for Sergeant Bo Bergdahl during this time. It would later be revealed by a congressional investigation that Obama misled Congress during this ordeal and sidestepped the requirement to notify Congress 30 days before the movement of the detainees, while also sidelining members of the Justice Department who are responsible for minimizing risk of sending detainees away. Obama would also have to deal with the rise of the Islamic State of Iraq in the Levant, which was ISIL. Obama would dispatch special operation troops and greatly expand drone strike initiatives, which led to the increase in civilian casualties. Airstrikes would also be used to prevent ISIL from spreading into Kurdistan's territory. Obama would also form a coalition in order to fight ISIL and other insurgent groups. He would also call for the world to come together against global warming and to fight the outbreak of Ebola in Africa, which also spread around the world, with a few cases even popping up in the US. A crisis was also brewing at the border of Mexico by 2014 as 50,000 children were detained while trying to cross the border illegally. Obama would grant amnesty following more gridlock in Congress to over 4 million illegal immigrants, granting temporary legal status. The order would also provide work permits to parents of citizens and delay deportation for a few years. It would also remove the age limitations of the previous bills and increase the year the immigrant had to be here from 2007 to 2010. Congress would also pass the Border Security Economic Opportunity and Immigration Modernization Act in 2013 to provide undocumented citizens an easier path to citizenship, but this bill would end up dying in Congress. In 2014, Obama would also normalize relationships with Cuba and the United States. Although Obama was unable to remove the embargo on Cuba, he would be able to provide the establishment of an embassy in Havana, a review of Cuba's status as a state sponsor of terrorism, and the easing of some travel and financial restrictions. Obama would also have to deal with the UNG5 and Iran initiative to limit their nuclear weapons program for 10 to 15 years in exchange for the removal of sanctions. The plan would call for Iran not to be able to buy centrifuges for the next 10 years, and also a ban of 15 years on enriched uranium. In return for economic relief to the tune of $100 billion would be given to the Iranian government. There were some concerns that Iran would use the economic relief to ramp up their aggressive foreign policy, particularly against U.S. regional ally Israel, as well as U.S. regional ally Saudi Arabia. There was also concerns that there was no plan in place to stop the Iranians after 15 years were up, besides the random inspections that would happen afterwards. The deal was made in order to prevent nuclear proliferation in the Middle East. This deal would of course be backed out by his successor. In 2015, Obama would also pledge to support Saudi Arabia's war in Yemen, which was in support of Yemen's previous government against the rebels in the Civil War. Obama would support the war through bombings and drone strikes. And remember that drone strike initiative that I talked about Obama starting? Let's see the final totals. Obama ordered 542 drone strikes, killed an estimated 3,797 people, with 324 of them being citizens. One of Obama's airstrikes hit a field hospital that was set up by Doctors Without Borders in Afghanistan and also took the lives of around 20 doctors and patients. Obama would also pass new climate regulations from the Paris Agreement that was with a lot of countries around the world, which included China, and would pledge to get the country onto renewable energy by 2030. Obama would also reject the proposal for the Keystone Pipeline around this time as well. Obama would also then sign the Trans-Pacific Partnership in 2015. This was a free trade agreement between 12 nations in the Pacific, which included the US, Japan, Australia, Brunei, Canada, Chile, Malaysia, Mexico, New Zealand, Peru, Singapore, and Vietnam. This agreement would never come to pass as leaders of both parties in the 2016 election opposed the deal and planned to get rid of it due to political unfavorability of free trade, and of course Obama's successors would get rid of it.
This deal and other subsequent foreign policy decisions was part of Obama's Pivot to Asia initiative that he had begun in his second term. The point of the Pivot to Asia was to focus America's foreign policy on Asia and away from the Middle East, where a good portion of U.S. attention was focused for the past couple decades. Asia was developing fast, and Obama recognized this with growing threats like China and North Korea in the region. Obama's successor continued his pivot in foreign policy despite removing the U.S. from deals like the TPP.
The biggest threat that Obama would have to deal with was ISIL. The Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant was a split off from Al-Qaeda. They fashioned themselves as the next caliphate. Obama wouldn't pay much attention to them at first in 2014 as it seemed like they were just another insurgent group, but they would grow and they would end up beheading two American journalists. After this, Obama would ask Congress for permission to fight them, but he said that he would do it anyway due to the powers that were granted in Bush's war resolutions. Obama would fight ISIL through the use of airstrikes and the training of Iraqi and Kurdish forces. Obama would also send special operations to groups in Syria to combat ISIL after a shooting in San Bernardino that had terroristic implications. By the end of Obama's presidency, ISIL's high controls of large swaths of land and Syria and Iraq remained as unstable as they were previously. Donald Trump would win the 2016 election and undo many of the changes that Obama had made, but that will be a story for next week. Barack Obama, in the end, is a lot like Reagan. He did some good, he did some bad, and he had some scandals. He was able to pass his health reform, but it would be riddled with problems. He was able to sign a great many treaties and trade deals, but he would suffer congressional gridlock on domestic issues and threats from both presidential candidates on his biggest trade treaty, the TPP. He was able to remove troops from Iraq, but he would become stuck in the nation again after the rise of an Islamic extremist group. It is only fair to put Obama above Reagan in the rankings. I think he handled the issues better than Reagan did, and also did more than Reagan, but he wasn't able to get much further than he did. Here are the updated rankings. Join us next week as we discuss the last president on this list, real estate mogul and WWE star Donald Trump, at least the last until Joe Biden's presidency comes to an end. The next episode will get at least one of the sides to hate me, or perhaps I will be lucky and piss off both of the circuses. It'll definitely be the latter. See you then!
Took his chance. Now let's see Barrett do river dance.